our visionary Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru. And when you think of Jawaharlal Nehru, don't confuse him with Rahul Gandhi. They are two separate and distinct individuals. And because of the misdeeds of the Nehru-Gandhi family, many of Jawaharlal Nehru's great achievements have been underscored, including his building of a scientific and technological base in this country. But he insisted that we will go in for universal adult franchise. He was opposed from the left and the right. The RSS said Pandit Nehru will live to regret the awarding of universal adult franchise. The communists opposed him. And elite middle class people, such as my grandparents and so on, said, you can't trust poor people with the vote. A Madras editor wrote that the 1952 elections were the biggest gamble in history. The American CIA said this will never be repeated because you can't have elections in a poor country. Now, this is an extraordinary achievement, and it's owed to people unjustly forgotten today. Some 20 years ago, I was giving a talk at the University of California at Berkeley, and on the panel was an Indonesian scholar in exile. And I was criticizing my government's policies on A, B, C, D, E, F. And this Indonesian scholar said, at least you live in a democracy where you have general elections. In my country, we have the election of the generals. So, our democracy, which is should be about more than elections. Elections are an absolutely fundamental feature of our democracy. Every time an election is held in India, it's a world record. Because every time there's a general election, more people have voted freely than at any previous time in history. But democracy should be much more about elections. Unfortunately, in our country, both major parties, the Congress and the BJP, as well as regional parties, are in danger of reducing democracy to what I call elections-only democracy. Elections are completely free and fair, as the Election Commission proved only last week in the Gujarat Rajya Sabha case. I mean, the Election Commission is justly regarded as a competent, efficient, transparent, and non-corrupt institution. But democracy should be about more than elections. We are in danger of reducing democracy to, you have an election, somebody wins, for the next 5 years that person is immune, or that government is immune to criticism. And this is not only at the central level, it's at the state level too. You know, state leaders are also increasingly, once they won an election, a state chief minister thinks that he or she is absolutely immune to scrutiny. So democracy has to be cherished, it has to be deepened, and it has to be married with diversity. Just as, apart from Sri Lanka, India is the only country in the post-colonial world that has consistently held regular, free and fair elections since independence. Across Asia and Africa, there is no other country. But India was not meant to be only a democracy. It was also meant to be a plural democracy. I'm sorry to have to quote Jawaharlal Nehru again, but it sometimes becomes mandatory. Now, Nehru and Gandhi had many differences. On economic policy, for example, Gandhi believed in a village-oriented economy. Nehru took the route of modernization and industrialization. But they were united by one thing, that is an absolute commitment to religious and linguistic pluralism. When Gandhi's greatness was that he forged a national movement which refused to reduce nationalism to a religious or a linguistic essence. And I think that's a lesson we are in danger of forgetting. Also, and this is also part of Gandhi's greatness, he refused to reduce nationalism to a single language. All across Europe, nations were formed in the 19th century on the basis of allegiance to a single language. Every Frenchman had to speak French. Every Polish patriot had to speak Polish. Every German had to speak German. But Gandhi recognized that in a country so diverse, with so many languages, each of which had extraordinarily rich and robust literary traditions, we could not have a single national language. He promised from the 1920s, Gandhi promised that when India became independent, it would have linguistic states. And that's one of the reasons we survive. Pakistan was created on the basis of religion, but divided on the basis of language, because Muhammad Ali Jinnah went to Dhaka and told the Bengalis, you have to learn Urdu. Sri Lanka, which has an impressive democratic record, its democratic record is blighted by Sinhala chauvinism, the fact that the dominant Sinhalas of the south imposed their language on the Tamils of the north, which led to an unending civil war with terrible, terrible costs. You know, Sri Lanka has much better human indicators, social indicators than India, in terms of age at marriage higher than India, infant mortality less than India, women's education better than India. Had it not been for this civil war, Bangalore would not have been the Silicon Valley of Asia, it would have been Sri Lanka. I say this in all seriousness. So the sustenance of linguistic and religious pluralism is absolutely crucial not only to the survival of Indian democracy, but to the growth of the Indian economy. Because unless there is safety and security, unless there is no stigmatization and discrimination on the basis of faith or language, you cannot progress. A precondition for economic growth is trust between citizens, is law and order. So there is our diversity, there's our depth, and there's our democracy. And I want to end with just a few words on what it takes to be a patriot. Rabindranath Tagore, who was a mentor to both Gandhi and Nehru, believed that there was a difference between patriotism and nationalism. A patriot is someone who loves his or her country. I'm a patriot because I love my country. A nationalist is someone who hates the other fellow's country. And we are in danger today of conflating the two, of substituting true patriotism with vulgar nationalism, or what we may call jingoism. There's one other thing I'd like to say about patriotism. There are two aspects of patriotism that I'd like the young people in this room to reflect upon. The first is that patriotism, like charity, begins at home. Democracy and patriotism begin at home. In a house, if you have a son and a daughter, you treat them equally. In a locality, if there's a dispute with your neighbor, you try and understand your neighbor's point of view. In the town, if there is, you know, some problem, you try and resolve it. Patriotism operates at different levels. It is not only love of India. It is love of Bits Pilani, of North Goa, of Maharashtra. So patriotism, to be effective, to be truly enabling, must begin with the home, the locality, the street, the town, the district, and the state, and then with the nation. And there is no inconsistency between being a Bengaluru patriot, a Karnataka patriot, and an Indian patriot. That is the lesson of India. There is no one homogenizing definition of patriotism imposed from the top. The other aspect of patriotism is that patriotism should be substantive and not symbolism, not symbolic. We will end our convocation today with the national anthem, which I will sing as lustily as any of you. But patriotism should not be reduced to singing the national anthem or to doing puja to the flag or shouting Bharat Mahan, Mera Bharat Mahan, followed by Pakistan Murtabad in the next breath. Patriotism should be substantive. It should be about making your home, your locality, your town, your district, and your country a more caring, a more compassionate, a more humane, a more inclusive, and a more dignified place. Thank you very much.